and welcome to another episode of the Aurora Essentials. Today on the program, I've got a wonderful man by the name of Mark Darwin. Say hi, Mark.
Hello, everybody.
Oh, there you go. Easy as that. You can talk. You can teach an old dog new tricks. No, just messing around with you. The reason I've got, I'm in beautiful Byron Bay here at the moment. The reason I'm talking to Mark is he is a wealth of information on what's really going on in the world that we don't know about, stuff that they like to cover up. You know that I like to talk about the whole, I like to say the word bullshit, it doesn't go over real well in some cases, but the crap that goes on behind the scenes, you know, the things we're being lied to, the multinationals, the drug companies, the banks, the lawyers, everyone you can imagine who makes money out of our suffering, in a way. Because if we take responsibility for ourselves, I'm not talking about growing your own everything necessarily, we don't have to go that far, but knowledge certainly makes a difference. So Mark's doing a series of seminars that come up from time to time, and you've got a whole lot of amazing guest speakers that come in and out. So if we could just sum it up in a nutshell, so to speak, give me the overview, then we'll go into depth with things. So what is it you're all about?
Okay. Well, we have a great organisation called Freedom Summers, which says it all. I think that a lot of our freedoms are being abolished in terms of human rights, our right to being healthy, our right to an education that's not one-sided, sending people off to university.
Ticking all the boxes as they want you to do.
Absolutely. And I think that I came across all this information through being quite ill myself and realising that the medical industry was not going to get me better, I was going to get me better. So I think that was the start of my...
So you started with medical. Let's go into that a bit more because, you know, most people know that, you know, medical or medical, let's just say health, not medical. Health is very passionate and very close to me. But when you say the medical industry, you're talking about, like, you're talking disease management.
Yes.
Yeah. So what did you find?
Well, I was diagnosed with a brain tumour on my left temporal lobe. And they told me that they wanted to start with radiation. I actually had two radiation treatments. And it didn't sit well with me. I've always been into understanding a little bit about food and the pharmaceutical industry. But you know what, Sam? When people tell you, when the medical people tell you that that you're very ill, and that if you don't do something, it's possible you're going to die, as much information as that I thought I had, I still went into a lot of fear.
Yeah. And that's it. That's what they work on, is the fear. Because you think, oh my God, I'm going to die. And we know, you know, we can call it the placebo effect type thing, but we know that if we believe, what we believe is most likely to happen. Now, when I say most likely, because some people think they believe, but they still doubt.
Yeah.
Because we doubt that we have the power, not just the ability, the power to actually work our own future, and it can be healthy or it can be unhealthy. Yeah. So how did you get out of the whole fear thing?
I have to be absolutely honest, when I was diagnosed, I did go into a lot of fear and actually started drinking quite heavily. And I went to one radiation treatment.
So that's like feeling sorry for yourself.
Yeah.
You just drown my sorrows.
Had no faith in myself, or very little faith in myself. But I think the turning point was waking up face first in the sand on Broad Beach with a face full of sand.
And it wasn't New Year's Day.
It wasn't New Year's Day, it was just any other Sunday with a couple of kids pointing at me, you know, they're saying to their mum, look at that man over there, isn't that sad? And I think that was a big turning point for me. I still went back for a second treatment, and halfway through the treatment I said stop. I knew it was wrong. And one of my favourite sayings is that when the student's ready, the teacher will appear. And I came across Don Tolman. I went to one of his workshops, and I just heard a lot of things that I already knew. I already knew as being true, but I think I needed to hear it again.
Sometimes we need that validation from someone else or something else, as in books and that, because we don't believe in the power that we have to change our destiny.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, with my story, you know, also going through cancer, the thing is, when you decide, now I'm going to take charge, that opens up so much. You become consumed in it, whereas you don't, if you become consumed in the disease management model, you end up a victim of it.
Yeah.
You know, if you get consumed in health and self-help, all of a sudden it gives you life.
Yeah.
It's like, wow, start again, and then you've got all this new information. It's like, well, now I've got this information. Oh, wow, I can't go back to living like I did before. We can still have our beer and have a drink occasionally, but it changes you.
Yeah. Well, I knew I had to get serious, and I met another lovely young man, and he was a young man at the time, 27, but one of these just really aware people, and I think young people are, but he was a big meditator, and he said to me, I talked to him about my situation, and funny enough, I didn't talk to many people about my situation. I was embarrassed and all the rest of it, but I talked to him, and he said, Mark, you're having radiation. He said, just listen to what you're doing. He said, you're really sick and you're radiating.
Yeah.
He said, just listen to it, you know.
How can we poison someone to cure them?
Absolutely. And I said to him, why are you so aware and calm? And he really was just one of these special human beings. And he goes, oh, I don't know. I do meditate a lot. And I asked him what sort of meditation, and he put me in touch with Vipassana meditation. And I have to say that I think food was a really big part of my healing, but I think meditation was almost bigger. It really helped me to release a lot of the traumas that I've had in my life that you carry in your body, because everything you carry is a sensation. And
well, if you quiet the mind, it allows real knowledge to come in, real wisdom to come in. And of course, most of us talk to ourselves continually. That, you know, if on your deathbed, all of a sudden you're on your way up and you meet, let's say, God, and you say, why didn't you help me? And God says, shit, I was trying to talk to you your whole life and you weren't listening.
Exactly, yeah. So that's what happened to me. And I think these Vipassana sits were critical in my learning. And you sit for 10 days in silence. Mm. And I'm a bit like you, Sam. I love a chat. And so a lot of my friends said...
with ourselves.
Yes, yeah. Oh, look, and that's what people said. Mark, how are you not going to talk for 10 days? But let me tell you, the voice is in your head.
Well, you can always fake dementia. I mean, I'm a grandmother now, so I just talk away and my daughters say, Mum, I say, that's all right, I think I've got dementia. It gives me permission to sing in supermarkets, you know.
Yeah,
because grandkids think it's cool.
Yeah. So look, I think that was the start of me really questioning authority.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the word authority is the author. Just because somebody authors something or writes it doesn't make it so.
Mm-hmm.
And so from there, I actually went to a workshop. My ex-wife sent me an email, and it said, come and learn about sovereignty. And I actually didn't even really know what sovereignty was. I think we bandied the word around, but I looked it up, and there was a few other things in the email. I thought, I need to go to this. And I ordinarily wouldn't go to a workshop like this, but it was a huge day. The whole day, my jaw was dropping with information about the banks, and I'm an ex-bankster myself. I worked at Aussie Home Loans in the early
You realise you've been lied to yourself?
I've been lied to about the banks, the government.
Was that Peter Duff?
Yes,
was running it? Yeah, I've been to a few of his, absolutely. Yeah, eye-opening.
Yeah.
And he spent years, was it 17 years, he kind of walked out of society. He was an ex-accountant, wasn't he?
I think
he was. And he walked out of society, went and sat in the Blue Mountains and basically
read everything. Read the Quran, the Bible, the Mahabharata's work, and all that sort of stuff. Very interesting man. And that was a pivotal point. I was the majority shareholder of a up-and-coming property group and financial planning and all that selling capitalism, which I absolutely don't believe in whatsoever anymore. So I walked away from that. Well, actually, the directors called me into a meeting because I sort of disappeared. I think once I got this information from Peter, I just went on a researching rampage.
Mm.
And everything that he said was true. And I think I had my world turned the right way up, because I think everybody lives in it upside down.
Mm.
And so that's what I've done now, is dedicated my life to sharing the truth about all of these areas.
Mm. So. It's funny, when we, and I use the word awaken, because it's a great, you know, we're basically asleep to what life is really about. When we awaken, we can't help but become consumed in it and then make changes, like pass on the knowledge, you know, teach others to do that, because we realise that it is up to us to do get the information to then pass it on, because the information that we get through schools, through the system, is all wrong.
Yeah.
All of it's wrong.
Yeah.
You know, it's like tick the boxes, A, B, or C, and you become, it's almost like you're institutionalised within yourself, within this whole, you know, this is the way that we operate, instead of going, whoa, what if we step out of it? But of course they can't control us. And one thing Don says, you know, we become sheep. We follow the leader.
Sheeple,
yeah, come on, so.
Yeah, well, that's what we do now. And funny enough, just to the off of camera here, there's a young man by the name of Oliver, who we met while we were in Scotland, setting a few things up over there. And he came across all this information through our site and has walked away from university. He's nodding his head over here. He was doing a business degree, and he's realised that even in sitting in some of the lectures before he left, he was just sitting there realising he was being lied to.
Yeah.
Being lied to big time. So it's great to see these young people really questioning what's going on.
Well, I think that, I mean, as they're saying, as I always say to anyone that's watching, do your own research. I mean, don't even believe us. Just go and do your own research. And it always comes down, I was talking to someone a little bit off track here, on fluoride, working with one of the local members of parliament in Brisbane to get fluoride out of Brisbane's water. And what I say is, anybody who does the research always comes up with, I wouldn't put that in the water now that I know what it is. You know, bottom line.
And this is water, by the way, it's not wine.
Yeah. Well, we can turn water into wine, there's ways. Go and watch the documentary on water. But, so yeah, it's getting the research, so then just coming back. So you looked at health, then you looked at the rest that went into it. Was there a spiritual side that went, that changed with, you know, during this whole, here's the outside world, here's the inside world, as in my diet and the way I eat. What was the spiritual side, or how did the change come about?
I think the spiritual side came to me through the Vipassana meditating. Before we started this, I told you about quite an amazing experience that I had during one of my sits. I've done probably 15-10 day sits now, but I'm still a pup. As the Buddha says, it's a long path.
Well, it's never ending. You know, there's always, because there's something there. So once you do get over into it, it's a whole new world you're playing with. You don't get in there and go, oh, I've got it. Yeah. You keep learning, like we do in this realm. We keep learning.
From a spiritual, I'm a bit funny with the word spiritual, but that's certainly where I found my own power. It's where I fell back in love with myself, because I don't think I was at all, which is why I was eating and drinking too much and working too hard and putting up with toxic relationships and all that sort of stuff. Mm. So I certainly found my inner power, but it was a lot of hard work. Mm. You know, through our website, there's probably been 80 to 100 of our clients now have gone up to sit these courses, and it's funny, they all contact me before the course saying, what am I in for, you know, or I've done this meditating, a little bit of arrogance, I've done all this meditating, every one of them gets out and writes to me going, wow.
It's these people say, oh yeah, I know that, I've done that, and it's like, no, let me tell you, even though you and I have both done a lot, we're still learning all the time, and there's always that new wow factor. I mean, I've got grown up children, and they're, you know, I'll be talking about something, and I say, listen, you know, I know a little bit on this. I've been, you know, researching it, and they say, no, you are consumed by it. I don't have a TV, so I'm Googling all the time information, and you know, there's a lot of rubbish out there, of course, but it starts to form patterns, and you go, wow, I know I'm in the right direction with this.
Yeah.
So, yeah, okay, keep going.
TV is a big point. We have a TV over here, but it's not plugged in. We haven't had a TV plugged in for a long time, and I can't stress enough how important that is to unplug from the matrix, unplug from the propaganda and the programming that comes through that about what you should wear, which school your kids should go, how you should look, who brands
it's on amazing here. Even through the ads, how much they do that subliminal training of us. And I heard something just the other day. I had radio on in the car, and it was an ad for the Aboriginal community through Aboriginal Indigenous radio. And I can't remember it verbatim, but it went along the lines that there was a grandma talking to her grandchild, and she said, you know, grandpa's got diabetes, you know, and the little kid says, what's diabetes? And she says, you know, the sugar. We have to watch what grandpa eats now. He can't eat those sort of things, and we have to support him. And you know that diabetes runs in our plan, in our people. So that child, he's been told. Mm-hmm. He's already growing up through the radio to be told that he is most likely going to get diabetes because it runs in our people. How about, well, hang on, what's the cause? Firstly, if you don't eat a Western diet, you don't get it. So let's change our diet and let's stop that happening.
Yeah.
So the radio ads, and guess who it was run by? Queensland Indigenous Health.
Yeah.
You know?
People don't look at this. They don't look at these things.
Sorry, guys, you don't know either.
They
don't know, because they get their agenda from higher up, and it says, you know, run these ads, educate people. Mm-hmm. And I do believe that they believe, and they really honestly do, that they are doing the right thing. They think we're educating people, let them know.
Yeah.
But they're also giving them the problem.
Yeah.
And all these murder things and that. I mean, I think it gives other people ideas. You know, they see this particular way that's happening. Oh, we can do that. Why put the TV on? Mm. You know?
One of my greatest teachers was a philosopher, a modern-day philosopher by the name of Alain de Botton. And he's got a great book and series. You can just buy the DVD series called Status Anxiety. And a lot of that runs into how we're so programmed through advertising and TV and movies, you know, all that sort of media.
Well, one of the things, too, looking on, not just the TV, look at, because I work a lot in self-sabotage, and a lot of it is the programming. So you've got the conscious level, the ego, and then you've got the subconscious and the super subconscious. It's amazing how much goes into our super subconscious or our subconscious. Let's just simplify it. Let's just say subconscious and cover it all. When it comes to what our parents say. And even though we may not be tuned in, it's still going in, and we'll say that later on in life. So if you look at self-sabotage, like, if you, you know, you're on a roll and things start to go good, and then, you know, you think, oh, I'm going to get all this money that I want to have, and then it doesn't happen, and you're like, oh, I knew I'd never get it. Money never seems to find its way to me. And you, and you'll have a parent that in the background will used to say, oh, we never have enough money. Money never comes in. And you're like, hang on a minute. Do I want to be saying that to myself? Or nothing ever happens good with me. And all that subliminal stuff that we pick up. And I've worked on ways to rewire the system and get it out. And I did it recently with some mental health patients. And the changing, the there and then, I just went, oh, I've been talking to myself on stuff that actually isn't even my idea. It's not how I want to think, but it's just been there.
Yeah, it's amazing. I find myself even parenting my children the way my father parented me, which wasn't probably the best way.
And it becomes automatic.
There's a lot of deprogramming to do.
Yeah.
So that's our path. We're running events called Freedom Summits. We have amazing speakers coming from all over the place, including the US and the UK. But one of the big messages that we have is that we feel that people are still enslaved. Mm. Slavery, of course, in the mainstream perspective, has been abolished. Mm. We actually think it's just been disguised very, very cleverly through debt and taxes and so forth. So I think that if people understand more about the monetary system, understand more about who the central banks are not a function of government, and this is not conspiracy stuff, you can look this up. The Reserve Bank of Australia, the Federal Reserve, the Bank of England, all the central banks are all privately owned by an elite banking cartel, nothing to do with the function of government. So then the banks have the audacity to create money out of thin air, and I used to do this at Aussie Home Loans. We would create these bonds. Little Mars and Pars would sign these promissory notes called mortgages. We'd fill the bond up, and we'd go and sell the bond on the bond market, and then we'd sell it again on the derivatives market, backing out whether it would work or not, which is nothing more than a legalised Ponzi scheme, in my opinion. Mm. But I think people need to wake up to the fact that they are enslaved and living in servitude with debt and taxes. Mm. And I think they need to look at what the government's all about too. You know, if you look at the Commonwealth of Australia, the Commonwealth of Australia is a registered company on the SEC in America. Mm. It is not a function of government. It is a private organisation, as is the ATO, as are all the state governments. So that has far-reaching ramifications, I think.
Yeah. I think, you know, this sort of knowledge has been, it's been coming out in America before here. Now, finally, where it's reaching here with people like you and others that are putting it out there. So your seminars, you've got, how many times a year are you?
We're going to do 3 rounds a year.
Yeah.
They're going to have between 8 and 12 speakers, and it's not that easy, you'll know, Sam, to coordinate, especially really busy people. And bringing them in from overseas. So we'll do 3 rounds and we're going to have incredible speakers. The first round, we put a wish list of speakers together. We've got every one of them. So the stars are lining up.
Yeah. Well, when you're there to tell the truth, that's what happens. It all comes, you know, it all just falls together. You've kind of got, you know, something from somewhere else just pulling it all together. So in a nutshell, if you've got a person that knows nothing, you're like, they've never heard of this, they just think you're crazy, what would you say in as simple terms as you can to have them go, yeah, maybe I have been right too?
Yeah. Well, firstly, I am a little bit crazy, so let's just stick with that.
We have to be.
Yeah.
Because we're living in this delusional world, so we've got to be the crazy to fit in or try to fit in as much as we can.
Yeah, it's a difficult one, especially with debt, because we help clients write to the banks and ask them a whole heap of lawful questions that they can't answer, and we negate debts. And a lot of people say, well, that's dishonourable. But people need to comprehend where the debt came from in the first place. Mm. And so one little factual thing that I can give people to think about is this. At the end of World War II, there were roughly 2 billion people on planet Earth. There are now over 7 billion people. Mm. Properties in the Western world are now worth 15 times as much as they were at the end of World War II. That's a lot of extra money. Mm. Where did the money come from? Mm. So I think everybody has to agree that money is created.
Yeah.
Now, people think that it's created by governments. I wouldn't have a problem with that. I don't have an issue with money. I think money is a great exchange of energy and goods and services.
Mm.
But when the money is created by these private families and banking cartels for their own use, and not disclosed, and then the retail banks have the audacity to create it again through fractional reserve lending and charge interest on them and not disclose any of the fraud here, then that's a big issue for me. And I think people just need to look at the mathematics of that. There is money being created. Who's creating it? And if you look at where the wealth is going now, polarization is out of control. And there's some fantastic things you can watch on YouTube about where all the money's going. It's actually less, when we talk about the 99 and the 1%, it's less than 1%, it's probably 0.1% that own roughly 40% of the wealth.
Yeah, yeah. And what's your website?
freedomsummits.org.
Okay, easy enough. So why don't you do a bit of research, follow the links, freedomsummit.org, and have a look at some of the speakers that Mark's got coming up, and, you know, get some real knowledge out there. You also, you've got online where you can, you know, send people into the right direction if they want to do some research if they can't make it to the seminars?
Yes, we do. We have another site called The Freedom Path, and that's basically an information hub, and there's thousands and thousands of hours of research there. As you said before, once you've gone down the rabbit hole or opened Pandora's box, there's no putting the lid down, and it can be quite addictive once you start.
You get consumed in it because you go, what else don't I know? And then the more you know, the more you want to know, because you realise, well, I mean, it's as simple as, and as complicated as, our whole history is just we've been lied to about it. So, you know, it's a simple thing by learning our real history. For a start, yeah. You know, the origins of man and that sort of thing. And thank God for YouTube, because that sort of thing, we've got, you know, just amateurs out there taking videos of stuff and you learn it. So once you get that, then get the politics of what's really going on. And of course, look at what we eat. Because at this point, we have death by knife, food and ignorance at mass proportion.
Absolutely. Yeah, but you know, there's nothing to fear. A lot of people go into the truth arena. And they're concerned about why the birth certificate was brought about. That's another whole story. Why the pharmaceutical industry is actually trying to kill us, and why the governments or corporations are masquerading as government, why it's all undisclosed. There are some quite evil premises under some of these things, but there's nothing to fear. If you actually come back to who you really are and know the right questions to ask and do the research, then I live a very happy, low-stress life, right?
Yeah, there's nothing to fear. It's less stress than what it was when we all had debts and that. I mean, I'm debt-free and I think, it's just so wonderful, because you're not part of that. You know, you're always under pressure to pay bills and things like that. And also, just, you know, just something you said about, you know, that freedom, I think we're empowered. Mm. We're empowered.
Yeah.
And look, really, what is it? It's more than a freedom. It's like, wow, you know, I know me, I'm in charge of me, my family, I can, you know.
Debt's a killer. We get clients coming to us with a black cloud over their head. Mm. They're not making love with their partner anymore. They don't know who their kids are. Their phone is ringing five times a day with debt collectors or the banks because they're behind in payments, and it is a huge stress. That is a dis-ease in the body. Mm. And once they go through the debt process and alleviate themselves from it and realise that it's all fiction. Mm. I mean, these figures are literally made in cyberspace. Less than 3% of money exists in coins and notes. The rest is in cyberspace, and it's created by pushing enter on a computer screen when they make a loan. So when these people do the debt process and alleviate themselves from it, we had one guy in particular, Scott, who lives on the Gold Coast. He was 130 kilos. He was a big man. He and his wife literally hadn't made love for a year. So the story that I mentioned before, didn't know who his teenage kids were, totally stressed. Got rid of his debt. I sent him off to Don. He started eating well. Within 6 months, his wife was very nervous at night time, and he actually ran the Gold Coast half marathon. Yeah. And we went and met him at a cafe, and we stood outside the Elephant Rock Cafe in Currumbin, and we're looking, going, where's Scott? And he actually said, Mark, Steph, we didn't recognise this guy.
Yeah.
His aura, his energy, his physicalness was all different.
Yeah.
He was so happy.
And in saying that, a lot of times we self-sabotage. You know, we have a plan to save this weight, and we self-sabotage. And the thing is, you know, we eat, or it's comfort to forget, and we forget. We're trying to forget what it is we don't even realise that what's going on. So something isn't right in our life.
Yeah.
And like you said, you know, you've got the debts, you've got that, things don't feel right, so you're like, oh, I'll have that beer, I'll have that bit of cake, and I feel a bit better at the moment, but it isn't the solution. Of course, once you actually do get it right, you're so much more empowered. So much more.
I think I can't stress enough how important Vipassana meditation might be for you to try, because that teaches you to observe sensation. And eating satisfies a sensation. Drinking alcohol satisfies a sensation. Sex satisfies a sensation. When you can actually observe these sensations objectively, in this body, not my body, get rid of the I, and start observing things objectively, these sensations pass. They come, they arise, and they pass away, which brings home the whole impermanence and living in the now. We can read Eckhart Tolle, we can read all these books who are blue on the face on living in the now, and we can intellectualize that.
Yeah.
But when you set these courses, you actually have to bring it into a knowing. Mm-hmm. And so when you can do that, there's so many people who cure themselves of alcoholism, sexual addiction, all other addictions, just by sitting in silence for 10 minutes, because they can start to... You can't feel these sensations. The unconscious is so powerful. But we go trying to satisfy these sensations unconsciously.
Yeah. And it's, you know, the knowing from within, we can, like you just said, you know, you can conceptualize it, you can think you can understand it, but then you get it. And one of the analogies I always give is like the analogy of gravity. Every time I let something go, it's going to drop. When I let it go, it's going to drop. We know it. And yet we know in a way that we have power over our, not over our body, not like a control, but we have to use this body to the best we can. You know, it's a fine machine that can be so wonderful to us, or it can be a prison to us. We can be incarcerated in our own skin, so to speak. Once you get obesity and get disease in there, and the mind's working, but you can't get out of bed.
Yeah.
And once we conceptualize that, it just, you're at peace.
Yeah.
Like I was driving here today, no radio, no music. I was in bliss. I was absolutely in bliss. I smiled the whole way. Trip went like that, and it's a 2-hour drive. And I didn't even have to have thoughts. I was just in awe of just breathing.
Yeah. And this lady's halfway through a 40-day water fast.
Day 19 today. So 21 days. I've got so much energy. I'm in bed.
We had to peel her off the ceiling.
I'm just drinking some mineral water or water. So this is my 8th one. So each year I've done one for 8 years. And, you feel good. You feel good.
I've done some 10-day fasts, 40 days, and I give the kudos there. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
But what you were saying before, it is, it's so true. People can intellectualize this information, and it almost becomes more dangerous.
Mm.
The Goenka, the teacher of Vipassana, tells a great little story of a guy who lives in poverty all his life, and then he gets the opportunity to go to a restaurant.
Mm.
And the restaurant serves food, and the moral behind the story is that the food is the truth. The food is the truth that he's going to receive. So he walks into this restaurant, and he gets given a menu, and he reads the menu, and he's looking at it, you know, whatever it is, dripping with tzatziki, and you know, his mouth's watering because he's reading this story, but that's the chef's truth. The chef's written this menu, and that's like we can read Eckhart Tolle, we can read the Bible, you can read whatever you want to read, and you'll be reading someone's truth, and you can intellectualize that it's true. That's all it is at this time. So he orders his food. Then he sees a couple at the table who get their food, and he looks at the food, oh, that looks delicious, and then he watches them eating it, and their faces are filled with joy. And that's when you meet people who have done the work, you meet people who have got the truth and live a true life. You look at them and go, I want to be like that. But that can be frustrating too. It's not till he gets the food or the truth and has it for himself and turns it into a knowing that he can be that way. And that's what he says. It can be dangerous to, it can actually have negative effects by understanding this information but not being able to live it, not being able to assimilate it, because you know how you should be living, but you can't do it.
And so the ego comes in and jumps in when it can, so that can sabotage you all the time too. So. Yeah, it's the knowing of it, and I find we need less friends, actually. We're very comfortable with ourselves, and I love nothing better than when there's no one in the house and I'm just on my own, you know, a bit of music and, you know, I dance and things like that. You don't need people. We collect people to make us feel better. You know, that person loves me and that one likes me, and also I hang around with them and they're like, oh, hey, Sam, you look great. Oh, we like, oh, hey, Mark, how you doing? Don't need it.
Yeah.
We don't need it. There's so much going on in here that, you know, do you need people? It's an interruption. Like, oh, wow, meditating. Where's my own space?
Yeah. I haven't thought of that, but back in my corporate wanker days when I was living the fast life, I had probably 50 to 100 friends who were golf buddies, drinking buddies, lunch, Friday lunch buddies, and that's all they were. They're all gone. Mm-hmm. I have maybe 2 or 3 very close friends, and one of them is my beautiful partner. But you don't need them.
That's it. You don't need people. So, all right, Mark, anything you want to say in summing up with that?
Yeah, check out freedomsummits.org. We'd love to see you along. We'll be in Sydney, Brisbane and Melbourne three times a year. We get a lot of people from Perth saying come over. It's just such a long way.
Other side of the world for us.
Yeah, getting 8 to 12 people to agree to that 4th event's hard. But Sydney, Brisbane, Melbourne, and look it up and we'll see you there.
Excellent. So thank you for watching another episode of The Raw Essentials. And this is one of those bits that steers you in the right direction. Start to go to different seminars, start to Google on YouTube, eat really well, and don't forget to drink plenty of water. Bye for now.
Thank you.